What is up, you guys? We're doing a little afternoon ski sleigh session, PJ and I. Don't go anywhere. We're about to get into some insane action. That's how it's done, dude. All right, PJ's in the water. Time to go get dirty. When I'm out there diving off the ski, I always want to have a buddy with me. There is a lot that can go wrong on the ocean, and it is not a good idea to ever dive solo. So now the gun that I'm rocking is that Blue Tech Bastard carbon fiber made in Greece, and I absolutely love that thing. Now the way that we're able to dive is one person is holding onto the flasher and a float line that's tethered to the ski while the other person is down diving, and this really helps the one up, one down diving situation. Now I'm the first one to make a drop, and just keep an eye on the visibility by looking at my spear gun. You can see it's really not that great, but whenever I dive, make that first dive, I'm always diving kind of close to the flashers because something could always come into the flashers, and you can also, in a situation like this, understand your depth just based on where the flashers are. So I always like to stick close to those when I make my first drop.
All right, so it looks like once you get past the flashers, is probably at like 40 feet because all city, I stuck my gun out, you can see like 5 feet like on the tip of my spear. The top wet like layer is like crystal. I think we should head a little deeper. And I think it's just soot from the beach, from the swell. Like, cause we've been having some serious weather. So I think best bet would be to send it a little farther off. But dude, it's crystal. Hey, it's Wahoo conditions, but we gotta catch up to the jet ski before it goes away.
Very sooty, pretty gross. And yeah, not diveable actually. Unless something came out of that sooty water and it's that whole bottom layer. So we're gonna send it a little deeper, hopefully. This top layer is crystal and it's good like Wahoo weather, so we might be sending it a little deeper and gonna go to a big wreck in some deep water. So I'll see you guys there.
PJ, don't be scared. Just follow me.
So now the top water visibility was just absolutely nuts. And now when I'm talking about visibility, I'm talking about the clarity of the water. So I'm probably about 30 feet away from PJ right now, and you can just see how clear he looks and how clear that water is. But now kind of towards the bottom, it soots out just like the spot before, but this is way better diving conditions than I've seen in the past. Now I make a little duck dive so you can just see how much life is on this spot and to give you some perspective. Now PJ just looks like he's floating in space, and when the visibility is that clear, you know it's gonna be a good day. Now I go ahead and make my first drop, and my head is on a swivel because I know how much life there is here, and also I end up getting greeted by the king of the wreck. And it was a big old bull shark, and one of the many that are lurking around. So shortly after, I'm looking for pelagics, and that is exactly what I spot. While I'm suspended in the middle water column, one of the most sought after pelagics shows its face. Now this is a Wahoo. It is a very sought after, fast growing, second fastest fish in the ocean, very sustainable, and most importantly, delicious fish. So me flicking my fingers is what they call squid fingers. It's kind of a last ditch effort, hopefully to gain the curiosity of the fish and have them come in. Now I do all I can to bring this amazing fish in, but unfortunately he's too smart, knows that I'm possibly a threat, and sends it out into the open ocean.
Wahoo! Big, did you see it? Big Wahoo, probably like 40 pounds.
So that was incredible. This place is probably the fishiest I believe I've ever seen it. And I mean, the fish were just all over the place. I felt like we were in like Africa or off of Fiji or something like that. We
could.
It was insane. There were just schools of fish everywhere. And there were sharks, and the sharks were just engulfed with fish. Like they were just surrounding the sharks as they're crucifying. There was lemon sharks, bull sharks, reef sharks. There was
I saw one Wahoo. I saw a Wahoo. He was off in the distance when I made a drop. I was already under and I kind of just tried to play cool, and you cannot chase those guys. If you chase them, just forget about it. So he was still chill. He might be around, and he just might be making passes around here. So we're gonna make a couple drifts, hopefully get a shot on one. That would be epic. Wahoo off the ski, that'd be unreal. Let's go, let's go. Another drift coming at you.
All right, drift over two coming at you.
So what makes this day and diving so special is the amount of life, and not just the life, the fact that the current is almost non-existent. There's hardly any current and there's so much bait everywhere. And normally you have the complete opposite of that. The only way that there's a lot of fish is usually when there's a lot of current. So that kind of makes today very unusual, but I go ahead and make a drop. I want to make it all the way down to the wreck, and you can see how that visibility kind of murks up a little bit down towards the wreck. And when you're diving these wrecks, it's very dangerous because there's a lot that can go wrong. Even if you shoot a fish, even if you have a good shot on a fish, they can go shoot right into a big hole in that wreck and not only destroy your gear, but could possibly drown you, get you tangled up. And it's just very important that you're cautious while diving these massive, deep wrecks. So on my way up, I just keep my head on a swivel, hanging out near the flashers, hoping another Wahoo comes in, but nothing does on this dive, but I do see some amazing life on this dive. So now shortly after, PJ goes, makes a drop on a yellow jack and plugs it, and he took kind of a long shot. You can hear me in the video. I'm a little bummed because I know the sharks are gonna give us a run for our money, and it does not take long for them to get on this fish.
Dude, not a wise choice. You should have locked in the brakes and just headed.
I did. I was burning it up.
It looked like you let him run too much at the beginning.
I let him run. Yes, I shot and he ran, and I
yeah.
Grabbed the line as much as I could, swim up.
Yeah.
It took off. It was a longer shot.
Yeah, I know. I wouldn't have taken that shot unless I had like a stone shot.
So shortly after, I made a quick duck dive, wanted to secure dinner. Then these sharks really made us aware of their presence. So now once I shot this fish, I made sure I secured it as soon as I could to create less vibrations in the water in order to attract less sharks.
What do you think, it's time to go?
I think it is.
Dude, there's only like 9 bull sharks at the surface ready to take a bite out of us.
Yeah.
Dude, I had to secure dinner.
What'd you get?
Bar jack.
Okay.
That was intensified.
Yellow jack. All right, PJ, walk us through what happened.
Take a dive. See yellow jack. I tried to not think about all the sharks around me, and I decided to take the shot on the yellow jack, and wasn't the smartest idea.
Yeah, that I knew once he shot, I was like,
gosh dang it. Because I knew you were close enough to make like a stone shot.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is not gonna be good, so.
I was hoping I made a good enough shot to where I could like just yank it up, but.
Yeah.
Nah.
Yeah, it was good size.
It was a few good size yellowjack fish, and I'm just happy I actually got experience with this ton.
Yeah.
Pretty much brand new to me, and even for that long of a shot, it was a full pass through.
Yeah. No, it was a landable shot on a fish if there weren't so many sharks, and it just got destroyed.
I think any fish of any sort of size, like of any good size, would have had the same result at that spot.
Yeah.
If it wasn't a
spot. Yeah, there were kubaras that came up to the flashers after he took a shot on that yellowjack, and I'm like thinking to myself, what are we doing?
What are we doing here?
What are we doing, man? You saw, I shot a fish at the surface.
Yeah.
Shot him and brought him to myself, secured him instantly. And how many sharks were around us?
It was
like 10?
Maybe a cool 10.
And the problem was they were the small bull sharks. And those ones have huge testosterone, and they are just, they're dumb. And they'll come in and just bite whatever
are
they see.
Dumb,
well, they're not dumb. They know what a spear gun shot means.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so I don't know. We might try another spot, or we'll head into the islands. I don't know. We'll
stay tuned.
Talk about it, regroup. All right, so this is what I got. These are the barjack. They're actually really good to eat. So we're gonna give them a try. Probably cook them over the fire. Head to the island and cook ourselves up something to eat. Gotta bleed this fish though. Oh God, be careful. Go. PJ just launched his load assist off of the ski. All right, you guys, that was some amazing diving. Beautiful life. Didn't get a whole lot of fish, but I mean, just coming out diving for an hour, so worth it. PJ and I, we're gonna go ahead and throw all our dive gear in a bag, head to the uninhabited island, go ahead and start up a fire, and we're gonna cook up this barjack, so stay tuned. All right, you guys, just rocked up on the little island, just PJ and myself. Took a little spearfishing adventure. Gonna do a little catch and cook. We're cooking, not really, not yet, but we're firing it up. So I'm gonna let this, I'm gonna use a bunch of these small sticks, keep piling them on there, let the coals cook down, get nice and hot. Then we're gonna throw that barjack right on top of the coals. So I'll see you guys when I'm doing that. So here is the surprise. I brought some African pompano. Mm. I brought a fillet of it from, if you have not seen that last adventure, I will link it up in the corner. It was an epic Bahamas sleigh session. It was not grouper and hogfish season, but we still made the best of it and got into some quality fish. One of those being an African pompano, spoiler alert. And PJ is going ahead and prepping it. And all the prep you have to do with this is just pull it out and cut it real thin and then dip it in soy sauce and indulge. We've already taken a bite of this stuff. It is pretty fuego. White nice stuff. Little appetizer for us.
Dude, so good. You pay big time bucks for this in the restaurants. We're getting it. We're sourcing it from the source.
Oh crap.
Fire already roared. Now the coals are burning down. And now we're gonna stick into this fish. Let's get into it.
This is hella chill. Here, you want some? Get a little appetizer. Off of the little palm branch.
Primitive.
Dude, this is about as primitive as it gets. Sick.
Oh yeah.
Dude, so good. Okay, you guys, so the coals are ready. You can see them. Actually, hold on, let me shut this light off real quick. You see those coals, got that coal bed. Looking real nice. All right, and the goal is to get the coal bed about the size of the fish. So I'm like been here kind of messing around with it. I want to elongate it a little bit. And then once it's on there, we can kind of push the coals up against it. But yeah, just throw the fish right on there. That is a Moby barjack. That is a Moby barjack.
Or mag.
That is huge. Hold on, let me shut this light off so you guys can see what I'm doing here. All right, so you see the fish? Just push all the coals along the edge of it. And then after a little bit, these coals will stay hot under it and keep, you know, sizzling and just cooking. And after a little bit, I will flip the fish, probably using some sticks or something. And then we'll give it probably, I don't know. You can't overcook it, you know that? It's really hard to overcook this.
Really?
Yeah.
It makes sense.
Because everything stays intact, so it's like just steams inside of it, unless you break the skin somehow.
Yeah.
But it's just gonna cook on the fire like that.
How long should it take?
I don't know, maybe like 10 minutes each side.
Sweet.
I have no idea, actually. I'm waiting. It's about that time. Fish is about done. Regardless, it's done. It's gonna
whether
be
we like it or not.
I it's mean, gotta be done.
This may be questionable. I think this is done.
Yeah, for sure. All right, but I don't even know if we'll be able to eat this whole thing. This thing's pretty big. Yeah. We'll go in and throw it on our little charcuterie of
palm
here.
Oh man.
What's it looking like? Oh dude, it's splitting.
It's splitting.
Splitting.
All right, great.
I'll flip it the other way. Flip it the other way. Yeah, like we'll put it down there. I mean that. You got it?
Yeah.
Here, I got a stick. I can do stuff.
You can
get
stuff.
The coals off of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, man. Dude. This is.
This is our great 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 granddad.
Oh wait, I have salt and pepper. What's it looking like? Oh, dude. Oh man.
Thick bloodline, but.
Kind of thick, but not too bad.
Not too bad.
Yeah. Just keep peeling the skin off of it.
Yeah. Here we go.
Oh wait. Oh, you're already giving it a taste test?
Oh, yeah.
What you think? It's not seasoned at all.
Not seasoned
I have salt and pepper.
I'd recommend the salt.
Okay. All right. We're going to salt and pepper it up.
Wait. Before we get into that.
Oh, wait.
We have here.
We got that soy sauce leftovers.
Leftovers.
Dude, it's like really cooked good. It's like cooked to where it's like hot.
Yes.
Oh my god.
Yeah, it's quite warm.
All right, let me scoot over here.
What was that?
I tried to jump. jump move.
Yeah.
All right, let me.
The bloodline kind of pulls out pretty good.
I know, right? I pulled this off of the bloodline.
Yeah.
And the bloodline is like, there's like a little thin. All right. There's like a little thin layer of blood usually between the skin and the meat, and so that's that kind of dark stuff that we're working out.
Mm-hmm.
We could probably eat it, but you know, if we could choose not to, I mean, which we have plenty of meat. Like, look at this nugget, dude. Primo. Gonna look at that
flakiness.
Check this out. I think I overcooked it. Just as I said, you can't overcook it. I mean, it's still good.
I think it's kind of hard to get a fish that's not a little bit dry this way.
Yeah.
And with anything like this, over an open fire, I've never done it like really on the coals like that, but.
I feel snapper is better on this as this recipe.
Yeah, because snapper has thicker skin. Scales.
Yeah,
and, it kind of protects.
Yeah, these
bit,
ones. These ones
it.
Have like no scales at all.
No.
Flavor's good, but it's chewy. But and I think that's because the way we cooked it. I think I overcooked it because it definitely got cooked.
Yeah.
It got real cooked. But either way, we're getting a feed. We're enjoying ourselves out here on the uninhabited island. Had a nice little afternoon of diving. I love doing stuff like this. It's crazy, it's outlandish, and it's odd, but I love it. Living off the land is the kind of stuff I love. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, go ahead and give it that thumbs up. If you're new, consider subscribing. And like always, you guys, I'll see you on the next episode. Later. I missed the camera. I can't see anything because of this light.
Yeah.
See you guys.